I got asked by Future Worlds sometime back in the autumn when I bumped into Brigitte and Ruben and Ben to come along and give a talk at the university, and it seemed like a really long way off. And I was like, yeah, I'll come and give a talk at university. I do talks in universities all the time as part of our marketing of our business. And then I forgot all about it. And then the new year came round and I got a reminder email from these guys. I thought, oh my goodness, I'm actually gonna have to do this. And then they told me it was gonna be called a masterclass. And I thought to myself, wow, I feel extraordinarily unqualified to give a masterclass in this. But I thought, you know, what can I offer? And what I can offer is just to tell you our story. So I was a graduate here from Southampton and I did a PhD over at the hospital. And then a colleague and a friend of mine and I started a business called Primer Design. It's gone on to be a success story, remarkably. 15 years later, the business has grown in a way that none of us really believed it ever would, but it has. So what I want to do from today is to try and convince you that if I can do this, me and my mate who set this up can go and achieve this, then you lot definitely can. That's my ambition from today. So this is a photograph of, these are scarlet macaw feathers from parrots in the Amazon jungle. And this is the headdress of a native Amazonian tribesman in the Amazon jungle. And this is a photograph that I took on my favorite ever day at work. I got to take this photo, I got to be paid to be deep in the Amazon jungle as part of my job. And it's just a great example of the weird and wonderful places that our business has taken us. So my story today, I'm going to tell you how I ended up deep in the Amazon jungle, taking a photograph of some parrot feathers on the headdress of a native Amazonian tribesman. So it's an unusual story, guys. It's the Primer Design story. That's the name of our business. So I'll tell you more about the story along the way, but the technology, what we actually do as a business. We're a DNA detection-based business, okay? So whatever background you're from, I'm sure you'll have some knowledge of DNA. It's the code of life. It's the thing that defines what makes you you. And you know that it's unique to you, right? I think that's fairly common knowledge. And so the DNA sequence of you is unique to you. The same is true of every living organism on the planet. So every living organism has a unique DNA code. So that includes things like viruses and bacteria and parasites, so things that make you sick. So if you can make a kit that can detect a particular bit of DNA, then you can identify whether or not a particular infectious agent is there. So you can, if I think maybe you might have an MRSA infection, I can go and take a blood sample from you, take that to the lab, use one of our kits to see whether MRSA DNA is present there. It's the ultimate, most specific way to work out whether or not a particular virus or bacteria is present. So we make those kind of test kits. We have kits for over 500 different infectious diseases, and they get used in hospital laboratories all the way around the world. And then the same technique is then used in other applications like veterinary diagnostics, what's wrong with my cat, or in the food world, have I got E. coli in my cucumbers? Or it also gets used in the research world. So if you have a particular bit of DNA you're interested in, you will want to have a kit that particularly detects that bit of DNA and works out whether it's there in the samples that you're working with. So that's what we do. We make those kits. Does that make any sense whatsoever? Good. So our story then, like any good story, has a beginning, a middle, and then in our case, an exit, which is a phrase that's used to describe when somebody sells their business, transitions, leaves. And that's where we've just ended up. This is a really interesting timing for me to be giving this talk, because we sold our business about 18 months ago, and I've just finished a kind of 18-month contractual period, and I've just handed on my responsibility. So I was the managing director, and I've now handed on that responsibility to somebody else. I found somebody who would be better at my job than I am, and so the company is moving on and continuing to grow in really interesting new ways, and I've become the strategic director. So I now work on a part-time basis, offering advice on the strategic direction for the business and working on particular new bits of technology within the business that I find particularly inspiring. So, for me, we've just arrived here. It's a really interesting moment, but I'm going to take you through the story as we go. So every story begins with a beginning. And this slide is blank. And it's blank for a reason, because this is the best moment of any business. This is the moment when it doesn't exist. And this is the thing that's really thrilled me over the years in starting our businesses, was there was nothing, and now there is something. And that creative process of something coming from nothing, I find really inspiring. That's the most exciting bit of a business for me. So you might be sitting here thinking, oh, I've got literally no ideas. I like the idea of running a business, that sounds cool, but I've got no ideas. Well, all the better. You've got the ultimate blank canvas, the ultimate set of opportunities in front of you, because nothing is yet done. And for me, that's the best bit. And that's why I'm interested to be involved in Future Worlds, because our business has grown into in a quite successful medium-sized business. But the thing I really yearn for is this moment when it's just like creating something from nothing, from scratch. So the thought of being involved with any of you guys who are thinking of doing that and being able to help or be part of that story, I find really, really inspiring. So yeah, don't be intimidated by the nothingness that is the beginning of a story. Right, like any story, there are characters in the story. So this is me, this is my colleague Rob Powell. And so it's he and I that founded and ran this business for the last 15 years or so. So just get a little bit of background about the two of us. So I'm a Southampton graduate, did a physiology degree, started in 98. Then I went on to do a molecular biology PhD. So we're doing asthma research over in the hospital. I then completed my PhD, went and worked in industry for a week before I realized, man, I hate working for a big company. This definitely isn't for me. I can't get anything done. I can't make a difference. Like, no, I don't think my boss is any good, all that stuff. So I lasted a week before I realized, and then I managed to last 9 months before I managed to find something else to do. And that was to come along and join in with what Rob was thinking of starting, which was a business. So I'd always kind of been entrepreneurially minded. I spent my whole time in my job pretending to do work and actually sitting there kind of sketching business plans on bits of paper, thinking, oh, I'd love to be in control of my own destiny and run my own thing. And then I was chatting with Rob, who was my old mate from the university, so he was still working in the Brook Lab over at the hospital. Now, Rob is our in-house genius at the technology that we specialise in. So the technology is called qPCR, and he has an extraordinary brain to think about little bits of DNA in a tube and how they interact with each other. He's got unique ability. So he was working in the Brook Lab there doing asthma research. And because he was the guy that everyone went to for advice on qPCR, he was ending up helping a lot of people with their research. He was helping them design their own kits for detecting their own bit of DNA they're interested in. And he ended up effectively running like a core facility there in that laboratory. And everyone would come to that lab and use our machines and get advice from Rob. And that was great, except of course, when you're a postdoctoral researcher, what you're really supposed to be doing is doing research and publishing papers. And if you don't publish papers after a while, then your career tends to grind to a halt. So kind of Rob saw this coming and thought, I haven't published any papers for a while, and do I actually want to go down that route and, you know, become a professor? Is that my ultimate goal? And he thought, no, what I really want to do is try and make a living out of the thing that I'm really good at. And that's one of the key things to being a successful entrepreneur. Find out what it is that you're good at or what you love doing. You know, what would you rather do for 8 hours a day than that? That's just a fantastic way to spend your career. So he thought, right, I'm going to try and make a living for myself out of real-time PCR somehow. And then meanwhile, I was chatting with him saying, oh man, I can't stand this corporate, big American organization I'm working for. I want to start a business. Why don't we try and have a go at this together? So I said, right, I'll take a stake in the company. I'll work for nothing, and we'll just see if we can get this thing off the ground. And so they're the characters of our story. That's how we got started. And so we started with some really key motivations. And I think it's something I'd really like to encourage you to think about. If you're thinking about starting a business, work out what your deep down driving motivations to make a success of it are, because sometimes along the way it's really hard. And it's got to be something for you that's going to make you, yeah, man, I really want to get out of bed. I really want to make a success of this story. So Rob and I had two kind of key motivations for us. So for Rob at the time, he was particularly angry with the state of the world, certain aspects of injustice that are going on in the world. He just really wanted to do something about it. He hated the discrepancy between rich and poor in the world and all that kind of stuff, and wanted to do something positive about it. And he thought, man, if I could make a lot of money, then maybe I could help with that subject. And some friends of his were running a charity in Uganda, which is effectively an orphan-based charity, so working with some of the most disadvantaged people in the world and doing all kinds of good things supporting those children, housing them, educating them, teaching them business skills. And you thought, man, if I could make a lot of money, I could transform that charity, and I could transform the lives of these kind of people. So he had this deep down desire to make a heap of cash. But it, you know, it's not the usual, I'm going to go and buy a Ferrari set of motives. It's like, I've got something special to do with that money. And that became a real kind of key motive at the heart of the business. So that was Rob's kind of key driver. And for me, it was that 9 months that I'd spent working in that big American organization that didn't care about me and I didn't care about them. And I just remember thinking at the end of that first week of work, you know, this is my first like proper salaried grown-up job. And I could see like 40 years of my life stretching out in front of me before I could get to 65. And I thought, who wants to do this every day? Like, I sleep for 8 hours, I spend 8 hours with my family, and then I'm going to spend 8 hours doing something that I really don't care about. I just thought, you know, that can't be what career is about. So I was just passionate that I was going to create a really interesting, very job for myself. But I want to employ people. I wanted to get people into our business and give them, you know, a really inspiring direction to take themselves, give them opportunities, allow people chances to develop as professionals, give them the freedom to do that. I just really wanted our business to be different from this other thing that I'd experienced. So my motivations were all about the people and the staff. So that was the motive to get ourselves started. We then thought to ourselves, right, we've seen Dragon's Den. I think if you start a company, you're supposed to go and raise some money. This is how naive we are, right? So I want you to realize that we're a complete pair of idiots at this stage. We've got really no idea what we're doing. I think we might need some money to start this. We haven't even got a plan, don't know what we're going to do, don't know who the customers are, don't really know what the product's going to be, but we probably got to raise some money. So we went to the university. So the university at that stage had a department called the Center for Enterprise and Innovation, which is now called Research Innovation Services or something similar. And we went to them and said, we want to start a business in the university. And they went, well, you haven't got a business plan, you haven't got any ideas, you've got no experience, and you look like a pair of idiots. So no, we're not going to invest in you. So that's a little bit of a kick in the teeth. But they did say, go and talk to this gentleman. So this is Professor Tom Brown. So until a few years ago, he was the head of organic chemistry here at the university, the professor of organic chemistry. So he is effectively the world expert in DNA, all things to do with the chemistry of DNA. So we were experts in the biology. He was an expert in the chemistry. And he'd had some entrepreneurial success, and so had a bit of money burning a hole in his pocket. And the university said, look, why don't you go and talk to Tom? He'll understand what you're talking about. He'll understand the science you're talking about. Go and have a chat with him. So Rob did that. Rob went to see Tom. And again, no business plan, no idea, no real plans of what he was going to do. Knocked on Tom's office door and sat and had a chat with him and said, Tom, I'm thinking of starting a business. I know about real-time PCR, the biology, you know about the chemistry. Would you like to invest in our business? Which seemed like a ridiculous long shot. But remarkably, Tom called Rob back again the next day and said, I think there's something here. I can see something in what you guys are up to. I'm going to write you a cheque for £30,000. So we got our grub funding. We thought we'd done really well. We thought, well, 30 grand, this is awesome. Then we went to the Centre of Enterprise and they defined it as grub funding, like the most like rubbish sounding word you could describe some cash. Because when you're starting a biotech company normally, you go out and you raise 2 million quid because you have to have labs and talented staff and really expensive equipment. And so 30 grand, you know, it was really considered to be a little bit of a joke at that stage. But it's kind of what we had. And it's a really key part of our story because it just, if you'll excuse the pun, it defined the DNA of the business for us. We had no money, so we had to make a profit from the very first day, otherwise we were going down the pan. Now, nobody makes a profit from the very first day. That's just not the way that businesses work, but we had no option than to do that. So we had to get really, really focused very, very quickly on defining really good quality products, making them good, finding some customers, and then, man, making sure we looked after those customers so they had a good experience, so that they would pay, and then they might come back and buy something else again. So it really honed us in on just those real simple business basics of make something that costs you less to make it than you're going to sell it, so that it makes a profit. And I see so many startups come and go that don't really have that in mind. You know, they've just got a really great bit of technology that they want to see in the world, but they haven't got focus on that simple concept of businesses need to make money, otherwise they stop being businesses really soon and end in disaster. So We're really thankful we had no money in the end. It meant we got paid nothing for many years and all those sorts of things, but a really important part of our story. So then we needed somewhere to actually do some business. We kind of had this idea. We knew we could build a website, so we built our own websites and things like that. So we made ourselves look like a bigger company than we really were at that stage. So at this stage, there's me working full-time for nothing, and Rob's working part-time and still doing his postdoc research on a part-time basis. And one of the things you really need when you're doing this particular technology is you have to have two laboratories, okay? So you've got to kind of make your kits in one laboratory, and then you have to test them in another, and you can't possibly accidentally get contamination from this lab to this lab. So if you've got a proper real-time PCR company, you have two labs and you have separate airflow going into each of them. So we're like, we need two labs. How are we going to do this? So we went to Tom, who was the chemistry professor, and we set up an agreement with his department and with the university to rent about half a square meter of bench space in his chemistry department. And then we're like, okay, well that's a good start. We can do a little bit of something here, but we need another lab. It's called a post-PCR lab. We need one of those. Where are we going to get that? So we went and asked the hospital, so where we had both done our postdoc, post-grad research, and said, could we rent a little bit of lab space from you? And we were fortunate enough, they were very kind, they lent us a little bit of lab space. We set up an agreement with them, and we paid kind of a peppercorn rent, and they let us rent the machine that we needed on a kind of use-by-use basis at that stage. And then as an office, I had my spare room, which is a kind of little house in Shirley, a rattly old spare room. And Rob had this, he was living on the Flowers estate with this kind of real ramshackle, broken down conservatory on the back of his house. And that was his office. And we started in about October, and it very quickly became very cold. We had a condition in primary design at that stage called mouse hand, which meant when you've been working in Rob's conservatory for too long in the freezing cold, your hand would actually clamp into the shape that had been on the mouse whilst you'd been working on the computer for too long. And so we kind of had offices, and we had these two little bits of lab space. But basically what it meant was I spent most of my time on a bike in between those two laboratories. So we'd go and make a tester kit in the chemistry department, and we needed to test it. So then I used to put it in my rucksack, and I used to then bike across Southampton, hand it to Rob in the Brook Lab, and then he would test it. By which time I'd bike back to the chemistry department, and he'd give me a call to let me know if it was working or not, or whether we needed to redesign it. And if it worked, I would then package that up into a product. We bought a nice label printer, made some nice packaging, so then we could go and deliver those to our customers. And then we spent our last few quid of the 30 grand on train tickets to London. So we would go on the university websites, we'd scour the biographies of all the academics there, work out who was using our technology, and then we went and visited them and knocked on doors and did our first ever kind of selling exercises, met researchers, and that went really well because we knew what their world was about because we'd been there, so we could speak their language. We knew what pain they had in trying to design these kits and get them to work. And we were really, really good at it. So we were able to promise those guys that we would deliver them a really high quality kit back to them within a couple of weeks, which would normally take an academic researcher typically, you know, a 6 to 8 week painful process. So we had this ability to help these researchers in a quick way, deliver them really high quality kits, which meant they get good data, which meant they publish papers, which makes everybody happy. And we spent our last few quid on train tickets. And then somewhere along the way in that first year, we got put in touch with Set Squared. So by this time, we'd kind of started to turn into a company. We've actually registered ourselves as a company house. We were a company, we had a few customers, we were underway. And so then the university were a little bit happier to talk to us again at that stage. They didn't consider us to be quite such a laughing stock at that stage. And they said, why don't you talk to Set Squared? So Set Squared is another organisation within the university. They're based off campus these days. Is that a key differentiator? So they're based at the Science Park, but at this stage they were based here at the university. And they do these similar kinds of things in terms of mentoring. But the key thing they had was an office on campus that you could rent your own desk, with central heating and stuff like that. So we managed to get ourselves out of our rattly conservatory and spare room, and we had an office conveniently next door to the chemistry department. And so we had a base, and then these guys would help provide mentors, people would come and give you advice. And crucially, they used to do something called a business review. So every 6 months, they would get a good quality panel of mentors together, and we'd go in and say where our business was at, and we'd get a chance to present where we're at as a business. But it made us really focus in on getting the basics of business right. So when we went to this business panel, we didn't look like a bunch of Muppets. And so it really helped us to channel and focus as a business. And we got through that first year, and remarkably, we got to the end of it and we added up the numbers, and we made a profit, which is just not what you're supposed to do in a technology startup. So it's one of the things that makes our story really unusual. And at the same time, we were part of the Set Squared investment raising programs. We were being coached on pitch. We were going to investment events to meet potential angels and high net worth individuals and investment funds. And we had opportunities for investment at this stage. We had people saying, okay, your business is going somewhere. I like the look of the profit margins. Maybe we could invest. But we kind of got to this point where we're like, hang on a minute, we've made enough money here to survive the next year. We could recruit our first member of staff now. And so we took a decision at that stage to not take any further investment and to try and grow our business organically from that moment in time. And that's what we did. We grew from there on without taking another single penny of investment. So we turned our 30 grand into the business that now exists today, which is a really, really unusual story. And so that's how we began. That was the beginning of our story. The middle of our story, which is the next 14 years condensed into one slide, if you like. And, you know, there's a massive amount of hard work going on here. We moved out of the university, managed to move into this building here. This is a photograph that I took to try and make this building look presentable. This was an absolute heap. It's like a derelict old factory down by the docks in Southampton, but it was really cheap. So we were able to have our own space, and for now, then we could have a lab here and then a lab like next door. So I didn't have to get on a bike to bike between the two. I could just walk from one to the other. That felt so luxurious. But like it was a manky old factory. And so our labs like had like beige walls, and like the labs had carpet on the floor at that stage, like brown carpet tiles. And so it was like, it's not something we could ever bring a customer, but it was functional and good. It meant we could grow our business there. And when we started to recruit, so company these days is about 45 people. This is a somewhere along the way when it looks like we're about 20 people. And then I was getting to do the thing that I was really passionate about. We were starting to get to create some really interesting jobs. We had people working for us who, you know, lots of people, it was their first job at university. We took a lot of sort of young talent because that was cheaper. But you know, lots of those people then went on to become directors of the business, have grown to they're no longer cheap. But they're, you know, they've had really successful careers with us. And we kind of did all the fun stuff. We've done all the paintballing and the raft building and all the kind of cliches along the way. We've got bright orange sofas and beanbags in the office these days and all that kind of stuff you're supposed to have if you're a technology business. So I was getting to do the thing that I really cared about, which was kind of building these kind of fulfilling jobs. And you should probably go and ask some of our staff whether I've really achieved. I think I've achieved that, but you probably go and find most of my staff really hate their job. But it felt as if we were succeeding in that way as well. So there's 14 years of remarkable hard work, and we grow year on year on year, and the profits continue to grow year on year on year, more to our astonishment than anything. We really started to feel like we knew what we were doing. We came across lots of other companies in our industry and got to know them and realised they weren't running such a good company as us. Their products weren't as good as us. Their processes weren't as good as us. Their focus on quality wasn't as good as us. And we really started to believe that actually we really know what we're doing here. And then along the way, there were these kind of really kind of key moments for us as a business. 2009, there was a swine flu outbreak. So we developed this ability as a business to make a kit faster than anybody else. So when the swine flu outbreak occurred, and there were the first few cases of that in Mexico, are you like all too young to remember that? Or does anybody here remember swine flu outbreak? Okay, good, thanks for that. We were like, okay, there's an opportunity here. We could develop the world's first swine flu test here. So we jumped on it and we did some night shifts. And within 10 days of the outbreak, we had a prototype kit in use in Mexico, diagnosing people, defining whether it was swine flu or an existing circulating strain of flu. And at that stage, the university did something else fantastic for us. We rang them and said, guys, we've done something which we think is really unique, really interesting. We've heard of something called PR. I think at these moments in time, you're supposed to make a noise about these sorts of things. How can we tell the world that we've developed the world's first swine flu kit? And so the university press office helped us out at this stage, and they did a press release, and they pushed this press release out onto the wires, which sounded great to us. It sounded great to us until the phone started ringing. And our whole world just went nuts for a fortnight. We just had every newspaper, every television channel, every news agency wanting to get our story. You know, the story was 10 days old by then. Everyone wanted a new angle. British technology company at the forefront of tackling world swine flu crisis was a really interesting news story. And so like, we had like news vans lined up in the car park. We had no press secretary or anything like that. So journalists were coming in. We had literal pushing and shoving in the corridor outside of our laboratories, with people wanting to have their turn to come in and like get the story. I was doing a live link up to the anchorman in the Sky News studio as like the prototype was coming off the production line. Just hilarious. Just went mad. And this is my favorite picture from that time. If you go on our YouTube channel, by the way, you can see some of the Sky News footage and all that kind of stuff. But this is a picture that I then took in Saudi Arabia a couple of months after that. So our business had suddenly gone from this kind of British organization, mostly focused on the UK research academic market. Suddenly, people all over the world are interested to buy our kits for diagnostics. And so we were getting contacted by distributors from all kinds of different countries who wanted to buy our product and sell it within their countries. And so we went on a trip to the Middle East, and we went to Saudi, Kuwait, we went to... where else did we go along that trip? UAE, Dubai. But me as this kind of really naive young businessman, it was our first ever abroad trip. And you roll into Saudi Arabia and it feels like a different world. It is, you know, it's an extraordinary place, Saudi Arabia. I haven't seen a woman's face for the whole week because everybody's in full burqas. You know, it's a country where at this stage women can't drive, so it feels like the most foreign place you could possibly be. And we got wheeled into the head office of this gentleman here who ran one of the big teaching hospitals in Jeddah. And it's a big cheese in the full dish dash, massive mahogany desk and a kind of line of important dignitaries standing behind him. And I'm absolutely wetting myself. It's a terrifying, intimidating experience. But he's there to talk about swine flu. And he's incredibly proud of himself because he has just had this article about his approach to swine flu published on the national newspaper on the front page. And I'm able to say to him, that's really cool. But you are aware that that is a photograph of my hands that you've got there on front of your national newspaper. And so we've had some photographs taken in the laboratory during this whole process. And those photos then became the swine flu photos that every press agency around the world then used. So if you Google anything to do with swine flu and see a news story, you will find a photograph of me pipetting Ribena from one tube to another tube. Because the real stuff was just really boring, clear liquid that no one wanted to see. So the photographer was like, can you make it look a bit more interesting? So yeah, we got some blackcurrant squash, put that into bottles. And that became the world's swine flu photos. And it really brought home to me in the middle of Saudi Arabia, a long way from home, that my goodness, our company's really gone somewhere all of a sudden. Because there's my hands on the front page of a Saudi national newspaper. So a really bizarre moment, but you know, a key moment in building our reputation and taking our company along. So. You know, I think the key learning there is don't underestimate the power of PR. So, all the things that Future Worlds are doing, all that social stuff, all the press, all that, yeah, it's really, really powerful. If something's on telly, people absolutely believe it's the truth. Get yourself on telly. That is an amazing way to accelerate your business. And Future Worlds are brilliant at all that kind of stuff. So we had another similar moment along the way. To be honest, every time there's an outbreak of anything, we now have a set of protocols that we just drop everything else and dive straight onto whatever the next outbreak is. So there's a recent bird flu outbreak. So our whole team has jumped on that. There was the Ebola outbreak. And again, we produced the world's first Ebola test in that case. And so we get the same press release out and we do find and replace for the name of the virus, change it to what the new one is. We send it off onto the news wires and then the phone rings. And it's always the Daily Echo who ring first. And then about an hour after that, BBC, Sky News will ring. And so we just do this trick every time there's an outbreak or something else. So it works really well. By the way, the Daily Echo, I think you mentioned, Celine, that you're in the Daily Echo. It's the best one, because although the Sky News gets you the big international coverage, like you wouldn't believe the number of people who actually read the Daily Echo. That is the one where people go, oh, I've just seen you in the paper. And like it's the one that makes your mum really proud and she'll pin on the fridge. So don't be too harsh on the Daily Echo. They're okay. The horse meat scandal. Everyone remember this one? Yeah, is this familiar? So 2013, suddenly we discovered that most of the beef in most of the processed foods we were eating wasn't in fact beef at all. It turned out it was horse. And now we'd already, so you can use exactly the same technology, right? So we have technology that identifies what species is present, whether it's a virus or a bacteria. I can also tell the difference between a horse and a cow with the same technology. So we'd developed a whole range of kits. So South Africa had already had this problem a couple of years back. So they'd had horse, but they'd also had like zebra and giraffe and buffalo starting to appear in food. So we had this whole range of kit sitting there that we were selling into South Africa. And then this story broke in the UK. And so we've got the solution. We've got, you know, we've got the answer to the problem. We can help everyone work out what really is the horse and what really is the beef. So our sales team just got on the phone to every laboratory in the country and said, who wants to buy a horse meat detection kit? And everyone was like, yeah, we want to buy a horse meat detection kit. So we had this brilliant moment where it raised our profile in another whole industry, so the food testing industry. So now we have a whole range of speciation kits, we call them. So we've got horse and we've got beef, and then you start to get really worrying ones, like people want to know cat, people want to know dog. We've got a mouse and rat detection kit. It's all like a little bit terrifying. But I'm not allowed to tell you which companies we sell those kind of things to, but they do get bought. Suddenly this whole new avenue of food testing opened up to us. So now we're doing the kind of listeria, salmonella testing, E. coli testing, and those kind of things along the way. And what was really interesting about that was we've been really focused on the whole medical world. But suddenly, you know, we had like, you know, Britain's biggest burger factory rang us up and said, I really want to know if what the lorry is delivering is horse or beef, because I don't want my reputation to be sullied. Can you teach me how to do this testing in my burger factory? And we're thinking, not really. No, you haven't got a laboratory. You don't know what a pipette is. Do you know what real-time PCR is? No. And they were like, we will pay anything to be able to find this answer out for ourselves before anything bad happens to our reputation. So we instructed them. We taught them. They built a laboratory. So up in the rafters of this like massive burger factory, they built a little room. We bought them real-time PCR equipment. We bought them the cheapest machine you could buy at that stage. And we taught them how to do it. And it went like amazingly well. Because these people they weren't scientists at all, they were process people. They were really used to following processes in factories. So when we taught them what to do, they just did that. And then they did it again exactly the same the next time and the next time. So they learned how to do real-time PCR, our technology, really, really well. And actually, compared to lots of the academic customers we send them kits and instructions, and then they'll ring us up and say, it's not working properly. And we'll say, have you followed the instructions, or have you been playing around thinking you know better? We don't say it like that. But quite often, you know, scientists want to have a play, and so they'll change things and change the temperature of this and add a bit more magnesium here and things like that. Whereas these guys were like, yeah, well, you told us what to do, so we're just going to do the same thing over and over. I honestly think this company now runs the best real-time PCR laboratory that I know of. They just nail it every single time, and they test every single day with our kits whether the delivery of stuff they've got is horse or beef or all kinds of other wonderful things. So we suddenly thought, well, hang on a minute. What if there are other people in the world who would like to use this technology that aren't scientists? You know, aren't there other people out there? What if the vet down the road would like to use this to work out what's wrong with that horse? Or you know, what if London Zoo wants to know what's wrong with its tiger? Well, how can they possibly do this? The kits aren't there. The technology is too expensive for them to do it. It's too difficult. What if we could take this technology and then simplify it and reduce the cost to such an extent that anyone could do this? Because there are a whole bunch of questions in the world you might like to get an answer to. So at that stage we thought, so the biggest barrier is the machine you need. Okay, so in the lab you need a thing like this big. It tends to cost about £30,000 to £50,000, and you need a PhD to know how to use it. We thought, what if we could produce an instrument that cost about £4,000 and was incredibly easy to use? What if we simplified the whole thing? And so that was our vision behind this, which is our first instrument as a business. So we call it the Q16. Because it can test 16 samples at a time, and the Q stands for quantitative. You can count how much of any particular bit of DNA you've got present there. I should have bought one. It's kind of about this big. It looks awesome. It just looks way like every other instrument in the industry is like this big kind of beige box, and it costs £40,000 and doesn't inspire anyone. This looks the business. And then suddenly we had a product that was easy enough to use. We priced it at £3,995, so just under £4,000, so that anyone could buy one with a credit card. It's under a credit card limit. So businesses no longer needed to think, oh, I need to go and get permission from my boss, purchasing department approval to buy the thing. Just like, if you want to buy one, give us your credit card, you can buy one now. And people have bought them. So we've installed these in all kinds of really unusual places. So yeah, Singapore Zoo have got one of these specifically for their exotic animals. You know, if you've got a tiger and that's your main attraction at your zoo, and it's a bit poorly one morning, you want to find out pretty fast what's wrong with it. So they do their own diagnostics there. We've got these at the Hong Kong Jockey Club. So if you've got really expensive racehorses, they screen them every single day for influenza. Has my horse got a cold? That's a question you really want to know the answer to really fast, because I didn't want to infect all the other horses. And we put them in fish farms. in Norway. So again, if you're in a fish farming business, you get about 5 million quid's worth of fish swimming in your fish farm by the time they're ready to harvest. If one of those is floating on the surface one morning, that's a scary time for that business. So they want to know as fast as possible what the answer is. And so instead of having to take a sample and send it off to a lab and get an answer 5 days later, they can test for themselves there and there on the fish farm. Who else? So beer companies. So the company that's behind things like Heineken and Budweiser, there's one massive beer brand that owns all of those. They're using our instruments to look after their yeast stocks. Okay, so the yeast that's used in the brewing process, that's their IP, that's their magic as a business. They have to make sure it doesn't become infected with other yeasts. So they've got this vault in the Netherlands. Like, have you seen Mission Impossible? Like where they break into the vault and you're gonna have two fingerprints at the same time from two separate people for the door to open. That's exactly what they've got in the Heineken factory there, and that's where they store all of their yeasts because they're so precious to them as a business. So they said, yeah, we'll pay anything to be able to keep an eye on our yeast stocks to make sure that they're as they should be. So they're using them. And Pucker Pies have got Q16 in their laboratory for, again, that process of seeing, is it horse, is it beef? But they also swab down their production lines every day to see if they've got E. coli or Salmonella growing there. Pucker Pies is a great business, by the way. Go and have a look at it. I thought Pucker Pies were awful. I went around the factory. They are so passionate about making really good pies there. I've completely transformed my opinion of Pucker Pies. Highly recommended. So we had this brilliant time launching this instrument that you could do real-time PCR with anywhere, and anyone could do it. I could teach any of you how to use this in half an hour, and you'd be doing molecular biology, real-time PCR diagnostic testing this afternoon. We could go and test the sandwiches to find out if there's salmonella in them. So suddenly we had an instrument that you could do PCR with anywhere, and then that is how I then ended up deep in the Amazon jungle one day, being paid to have the absolute time of my life doing real-time PCR deep in the Amazon jungle. And we just thought, we've got this message, which is, you can do this anywhere, anyone can do it. So we really wanted to communicate to the world in our marketing just how easy it would be to do this anywhere. So we thought, what would be the ultimate place to go and do real-time PCR? And we thought, well, the space station would be pretty cool, but we didn't manage to pull that one off. And we thought, what about deep in the jungle? So we had a distributor in Brazil, so we were traveling around all over the world at this stage. And so we went to visit our distributor in Brazil, and we spent some time in Rio and Sao Paulo. And whilst we were there visiting customers in Brazil, we went to the jungle, and we did real-time PCR in the jungle, and I had my best ever day at work. And I'm going to show you our little marketing video that we made at that stage, because it's quite good fun.
We are Primer Design. We produce the GeneSeq Q16. It makes it easy to carry out a DNA test in any environment. So we're taking one out of the lab and to somewhere altogether less traditional. We've travelled 5,500 miles to the heart of the Amazon jungle. The plan is to test for chikungunya and dengue fever, two vector-borne diseases prevalent in this area. Our test sample will come from one of the natives. And although this kit works well with human blood, on this occasion, we're going to test this very large, grumpy local mosquito. The GeneSeq Easy Extraction Kit, along with the GeneSeq Easy Lab in a Box, make it simple to extract nucleic acid from just about any starting material, even a whole insect. You don't need any other special equipment. In fact, you don't even need a lab. Once we have our RNA, it's combined with our GeneSeq Easy Test Kit and loaded into the instrument. It takes around 90 minutes to analyse the sample, which gives us plenty of time to enjoy the local wildlife. Out in the field, you can choose to operate the Q16 without a computer. The data is instead stored onto a USB drive. So later, back in the hotel, we can see the results. The automated analysis shows that this particular bug was negative for dengue and chikungunya. But the data also shows that the test and the Q16 performed perfectly. Certainly one of the most amazing tests in the most amazing places we've ever done. The GeneSeq Q16 from Primer Design. DNA testing for everything, everyone, everywhere.
So there you go, that's how you end up deep in the Amazon jungle, doing something you really love and getting paid to do so. Just an extraordinary part of our journey. And there's been so many moments along the way where we thought, what on earth are we doing here? How have I ended up in this part of the world getting to do this for a living? So 14 years on, it's grown into a real success story. So we've now moved again. So we now have a kind of 20,000 square foot for purpose-fitted laboratories just on the outskirts of Southampton. We've got about 10,000 plus customers in 100 plus countries around the world. We still have a lot of focus here on the UK academic market. So we've got customers in every UK university whom we support with their real-time PCR. And we're selling to all these other weird and wonderful industries, you know, the diagnostic industry, but the veterinary industries, the food and water testing industries as well. And my dreams have come true in terms of creating jobs. And I think we've created jobs that are fulfilling and interesting. And we've employed more than 50 people over the years, which for me is a real thrill. So this is what our facilities now look like. There's no longer carpet on the floor of the laboratories. It looks shiny and white and like a laboratory ought to. It's a really spectacular place to bring customers. And we do, we bring customers there all the time. It's just a great place to work. So I don't know if any of you are biological graduates, but we are always recruiting, we're always growing our team. So if you or a colleague is looking for a job in a really interesting, fast-growing, young biotechnology company, follow us on Facebook or Twitter or LinkedIn, or just go to our website and keep an eye on the jobs page. We love our connection with Southampton University. We've recruited a lot of people from the university over the years, and we particularly enjoy providing employment to people who have come through the university that way. It's been quite a story. And the story comes to an end for me because, as I said, I've just handed on responsibility to someone else to run our business these days. And it was kind of 14 years on. And it just got to the stage where the business needed a different kind of leader to take it to the next level. It's going to continue to grow and be an even bigger success story. But it was no longer an entrepreneurial exercise. It was no longer about creating something from nothing. And that's the thing that I really yearn to go get back to. So my plans is to go and start more businesses. So I'm really delighted to have found somebody who's going to be a fantastic new leader of the business and continue to take it in the direction that I hope for. All of the other bottom lines for the business have been fulfilled. People say to you, why have you crystallized the business? Why did you sell it if it's so great? And you've got to remember that one of the key objectives of this business was to try and make money, to try and do something about some of the world's biggest injustices. And so if you're a couple of academic guys who have built a business and it ends up being worth a few quid, you get to the stage where you think, well, we've got to turn this into cash so we can do the things that we've dreamt of. And so we've been able to put lots of cash into those orphan projects, one in Uganda and one in India over the years. But when we launched this video with us in the jungle, it created an enormous amount of attention for us as a business. And we kept on being approached and approached and approached by people who were interested to buy the business from us. And eventually you think to yourself, actually, if it really is precious to me to fulfill some of these other goals, we need to turn some of this into cash. And so that would be the big driver of why we then took a decision to sell the business. We've built real infrastructure in some of these places. We've built schools, we've built businesses, we've built a hotel. And we've built a legacy, the ability for these communities to be generating their own income out of the businesses that have been developed there. And, 100 plus year legacy is the outcome for Rob and I personally in the Primer Design story. So, we're pretty satisfied with the outcome. We come to a conclusion, which is where it's a really interesting exercise for me, because I'm supposed to be coming here to try and inspire you or something, to convince you that you ought to be starting your own company again. But I'm at a moment where I'm thinking, well, I'm going to go and start a company again. So what a brilliant exercise for me to go to think, what are the key things that I believe are important about being a successful entrepreneur? And I've just got a few of those. I'd really encourage you to find out what really motivates you. Because I said along the way, it's really difficult along the way at certain moments. It becomes very stressful at times. There's difficult things all the way through the journey. There are different kinds of stresses. And sometimes you're going to need a reason to get out of bed in the morning. And if that is just about the money, I'd be really surprised if that's enough to make you fulfilled as a human being in what you're doing. But if you find better things than that, then it never feels like going to work. It feels like you're having the absolute time of your life. running your own business. It's an extraordinary privilege. So find a motivation for you that, build that into your business plan. Make that part of, the bottom line that you're interested to, develop. One of the really unusual things about Primer Design is that it doesn't hold a single patent as a business. So I'm not talking about going and infringing other people's patents and IP. I'm just saying you don't always need like the biggest idea ever or a completely unique thing. And I think when we watch Dragon's Den and when we hear about brilliant, exciting things going on inside the universe, they are very, very novel. And that is brilliant. And I've never had the privilege of running a business which has got something unique like that. But we didn't ever have that. We just took an existing technology and we just did it better than anybody else. We got better at it than anybody else. And we put a massive emphasis on customer service. And we put a massive emphasis on taking care of our staff. And that is a real recipe for business success. So don't think to yourself, oh, I haven't got a patent. I haven't got a brilliant new technology. Is there something that you could use to build a business? You don't have to have something utterly unique to build a valuable business. Don't go it alone. So my mate Rob, we are chalk and cheese. He's utterly different from me. He's a complete left brain and I'm a complete right brain person. And sometimes we drive each other completely bananas. But actually having two opposite personalities is brilliant when it comes to problem solving. You're gonna have to solve 100 problems a day, every day, whilst you're growing and starting and building your business. And so just doing that on your own is relentlessly exhausting. So do it with someone else. Find a mate who you really trust, who you can do business with. And I think it doubles your chances of having a success because you won't get as worn out. And the trust thing's really important. If your business is successful, you'll have to make multi-million pound decisions together. And that will really test a friendship. So it's really important that you get all of that stuff right along the way. But yeah, don't go it alone. That's my advice. And then my final slide is, look, it's easy. I mean, it's not easy. It's really hard work. But everyone knows how to run a business. You make something or you provide a service. And then you make sure that you sell it for more than it cost you to make. That's it. Okay, so you all know that. And you've all got bosses and you know and think they're rubbish. So you know you can do better than they can. So you know, there's no reason at all why you couldn't start a business. Find an idea, find something you're passionate about, find a bottom line that really interests you, and there's no reason at all why you couldn't go and start a business and be looking at a real success story. That's your lot, guys. Our business model was about, it's kind of the razor and razor blade model. The instrument itself allows people to do the test, but the profit margins for us are in selling the actual test in the long run. Whereas the bigger businesses have kind of highly over-engineered, too clever instrumentation that they have to charge 30 grand for to make it a viable proposition. Well, we thought, well, let's simplify it. Let's find what's the really important bit of this instrument, make that available to customers. And then it didn't cost so much to make. So we don't really make any margin at all when we're selling the instrument, but it means we can put it into somebody's hands affordably, and then we can make our margin on the consumables. Thankfully, I was married. I had a wife with a massive trainee teacher's salary of 17.5 grand. So yes, she took care of us, and we ate baked beans until we could afford some bread to go with it. We just lived well within our means, and we didn't have a car, and I rode my bike to and fro, and we just made it work because we had to. And it was a unique moment in life because we were newly married, no kids, no kind of big bills in life, none of the responsibilities that come with being a proper grown-up. So at that stage, she just said to me, look, you are absolutely miserable doing that other thing you're doing. Just do anything else that doesn't make you miserable. And that, you know, that was, we'll eat baked beans because that would be better. But I think, you know, at that stage, there's a really, and I guess lots of you will be at that stage, you haven't got big grown-up responsibilities yet. That is a brilliant time to start a business, because if you get to, you know, if you get to my age now and you've got a mortgage and kids and all that kind of stuff, and then you said, right, now I'm going to take the risk and go and work for no money for the next year and a half, that's a much bigger barrier to getting started. So it's a really unique moment in life to go and start something. It's a good question. Yeah, so typically for one of our big competitors, so we are up against companies like Roche, Qiagen, Life Technologies, Thermo Fisher. So these are multi-billion dollar organizations who we're up against. For them to take a product from idea to launch is about an 18-month process because they're big. And they're big and they're slow and they're cumbersome. Whereas we built our whole business was around this one particular thing. We're going to be the best in the world at developing real-time PCR assays. So that's all we do. Okay, and so we built all of our processes and our standard operating procedures into this extremely streamlined thing. So everyone knows what their step of the journey is. So when something new like swine flu comes along, all we need is the genetic information. We just need to know what the sequence for that particular virus is. And as soon as we've got that, we can put it into our machine, you know, our business, the pipeline. Everybody will do their bit. It's a very quick process, and we can produce a functioning prototype kit in about 10 days. So our very, very first customers were friends and colleagues from the university here who we'd worked with. But then after that, it was just, it was a matter of going and knocking on doors. So, yeah, it was that process. Go on a website, find a researcher who looks like he might be using that kind of PCR. Give him a call. We used to say we're a university spin out. I'd love to talk to you about your real-time PCR. That's an easy way to make a cold call. Because like, cold calls is terrifying, right? No one wants to be doing that. But because we were academics, and so everyone kind of trusted us, and we were real experts in what we were doing. So we had a very high quality conversation, scientist to scientist. So people would very quickly trust that we knew what we were talking about. But then the key was to make sure that we really did deliver something good for them. Because, you know, if we got it wrong at that stage, our reputation would have been sullied instantly, and it would have fallen over. But we made really good real-time PCR assays for people, and they worked. And so people then told their friends, and they told their friends, and our reputation began to grow. Yeah, I should probably tell you, I had just this really clear vision of exactly where it was going to go, and I knew exactly where it was going to go. No, I just thought, man, I really hate my job. It'd be a lot more fun to run a business. I could be my own boss. That'd be great. I had a couple of kind of key things in my mind about the number of staff that I'd be feel like job done. And certain milestones, there was a particular amount of business I wanted to do in the UK in 1 year. That was like our home patch, and I thought, wow, I've got a number. So I had some particular milestones in my head, but you know, the business grew beyond my vision. Yeah, it surprised us all as to how successful it had been.
Again, thank you, Jim, so much for the questions and all that. Again, a round of applause, please.